A very good afternoon, distinguished guests, speakers, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Roshni, and I have the pleasure of being your MC today. On behalf of the Institute of South Asian Studies, ISAS, at the National University of Singapore, I welcome you to this afternoon's panel discussion titled India Budget 2018, Discussing the Decisions. Ladies and gentlemen, I would now like to invite on stage the following distinguished panelists for the panel discussion. Dr. Duvvuri Subbarao, Distinguished Visiting Research Fellow at ISAS-NUS and former Governor of the Reserve Bank of India. Ms. Sonal Varma, Chief India Economist at Nomura Singapore Limited. And Dr. Venkatraman Anantha-Nageswaran, Co-Founder and Member, Investment Board. Investment Board, Aavishkaar Venture Management Services. I would also like to invite the chairperson for this session, Dr. Iftekhar Chowdhury, Principal Research Fellow at ISAS-NUS and former Foreign Minister of Bangladesh, to join us. And now I would like to hand the floor to Dr. Chowdhury. Thank you.
Statement under Article 112 of the Constitution was presented by Finance Minister Arun Jaitley on the 1st of February. By the way, the word budget is derived from the French budget, meaning a leather pouch. And in this case, the Finance Minister's briefcase. In India, it has always been done in February to allow for the passage of the bill through both houses before it takes effect on the first day of the financial year, which is 1st April. Earlier, the event would have taken place on last year, February, but Mr. Jaitley moved it to the 1st of February 2017, and this tradition is likely to continue. The current budget acquired additional significance, even without the context. In two principal ways. First, it came in the wake of the two major headwinds, demonetization and the goods and services tax, the GST. Secondly, it was also the BJP government's fifth and the last presentation before the Lok Sabha polls, which are due in 2019. In budget preparations, timing can, and does, create compelling impetus. In most countries, interesting rituals surround the presentation. In India, concerned officials are isolated, and I was talking to Dr. Subbarao the other day, and hold up in the North Block for about a week as the document is finally printed. To relieve the drudgery, the finance minister presents them with large quantums of sweets in what is known as the halwa ceremony. This is done in consonance with the Indian tradition of sweetening the mouth before an important event. A similar culture also obtains in my own country, Bangladesh. Now, a footnote on the importance of secrecy of budgets. In Britain in 1947, the Chancellor of the Exchequer, in Clement Attlee's Labour government, the famous economist Hugh Dalton, was about to present the budget. He came out of the chambers, the Commons chamber, for a breather. And saw a bunch of waiting journalists. He went up and quipped, "Have a drink with you chaps, because tomorrow you're going to have to pay more for it." Immediately the journalists rushed to the phone booths and reported that alcohol was being taxed. Because of that fatal leave, Dalton resigned. It was the most costly fall. Back to the budget. With the elections just beyond the rim of the saucer, I suppose it was important for the government to boost the rural agro economy and ensure that the country was on track to achieve 8% growth on a sustainable basis. So, four engines of the economy were pumped prime. First, boosting of consumption. Second, sharp and focus on investments. Third, expanded exports. And fourth, employment creation. The overarching idea was that the gap between Bharat of the villages and urban India would be reduced. It raises some questions. Is the time available, 11 months, enough to do all that? Is the health insurance scheme already termed Modicare implementable? Is the budget overly populist or genuinely popular? How are the markets reacting to the capital gains tax? What would be the impact on the ease of doing business? Is this a game changer, as some of its supporters claim, or simply a name changer, as detractors allege? From our deliberations today should emerge the responses, not just to these queries, but also to the larger quiz. And this is whether what is increasingly being called Bharatonomics is the triumph, whether it is a triumph of an ideological imagination or the fulfillment of an aspiration to achieve a comprehensive package of equitable gains for all, embodying Sabka Saath. Now to quickly cut to the chase and come to the horses. ISAS has gathered three extremely prudent analysts to speak to these and other related budget issues. The stellar group comprises Dr. Duvvuri Subbarao, distinguished fellow at ISAS and former governor of Reserve Bank, as you've heard. Ms. Sonal Varma of the India, chief economist of Nomura Singapore Limited. And Dr. Anantha-Nageswaran, well-known economic commentator and former banker. We will begin with Dr. Nageswaran, and I will give the floor to him for the next 30 minutes.
Of the Indian government. I was hoping to go last because as in a limited over match of handshakes, it is good to have a sense of what others have spoken and you can either build on it and take some of those information as given so that I don't have to repeat it. But I guess I now have to pass on the advantage to my colleagues who can build on some of the information that I would be presenting and probably be able to concentrate on other aspects better. One thing I realized in the last 1 week, as I've been spending more time on this budget, the more you know, the less you are sure as to whether it is good or bad or indifferent or I do nothing, or I do everything by day. I must confess, I'm more confused than clear in my head as to whether this budget has done a bad job, or a botched job, or a terrific one. Let's see what you conclude at the end of it. So I want to set the context first for the budget. A lot of us probably didn't pay attention to the fact that Fitch Ratings Agency produced a report which surprisingly is publicly accessible, not restricted to subscribers, in January 2018, which picked a few emerging economies and tried to analyze their maximum possible growth rate over the next 5 years. That's what they said. They put India on top of the list with 6.7% potential growth over the next 5 years, China slightly lower than 6 in fact, and others further down the chain. But whether 6.7 is adequate for India's employment, demographic, and other challenges is a different issue. But although they put India at the top of the pecking order, they did have some comments to make, which is that India's labor force participation rate in general over the last 35 years has been coming down. Maybe in the last couple of years it has stopped declining and slowly creeping up. But the truth is, from 68%, we are just a little bit shy of 60%. And naturally, we all know that GDP growth is a sum of labor force growth and productivity growth. So to that extent, I think this does place some ceiling on the maximum achievable growth rate. And they also said, and I've highlighted the key sentences which they pointed out, in spite of starting from a low base, a relatively poor country, total factor productivity growth, basically growth that is not explained simply by addition of labor and capital. I mean, some of you here in this part of the world would recall the remarks of Paul Krugman in the 90s, before the Asian crisis happened, that bulk of Asia's, East Asia's growth miracle was a pure capital accumulation miracle and not a productivity miracle story. So something similar here is at work. The total factor productivity growth has been just about 0.6% per annum in the last few years, and starting from a low base, it is all the more disappointing, that's what they said, despite putting India at the top of the heap. So that is one of the contexts, which is that productivity growth rate is low, labor force participation has been declining, and maybe it has stopped declining, but hasn't begun to rise. And then now I switch on to the economic survey, which is presented a few days before the budget. And in chapter 3 of that economic survey report, there is this interesting chart which shows that India's investment to GDP ratio and savings to GDP ratio have been coming down. On the right side, you see the average of some other emerging market economies which haven't shown a similar decline in the last several years. If anything, the decline in the investment to GDP ratio has been about 9 percentage points, the savings. And the investment has been somewhere between 35 to 26, equally the same, between 7 and 9 percentage points. If you sort of move the lens to a closer time frame, this is based on the new data released on January 31st by India's Central Statistical Organization. The gross fixed capital formation, which is even more precise, in excluding inventories, etc., you basically see that it's come down from 34% in 2011-12 down to around 29%, a 5 percentage point drop, and the savings rate from around 34 to barely about 30. So this is the most recent data released on the 30th. So you do have a problem. And very seldom in emerging economies have you seen both savings and investment ratios coming down simultaneously for such a long period of time, over 8 years, after the peak in 2006 and 2007, and more importantly, as the survey put it rather grimly, so that's why it's good to know inverted commas, it may not be over yet. This is what the survey said. And they also said, not only the bottoming out process is not over, when it starts recovering, you hardly go back to even half the peak of the ratios before the decline started. In other words, if India's investment rate was 36% of GDP and it stops at 26%, they say that maybe on an average you will get back to about 30% of GDP and not back to 36% of GDP. The same thing goes for savings. So they are basically saying that the recovery will be shallow, and in India's case they say the decline seems particularly difficult to reverse, partly because it stems from balance sheet stress in corporations, in banks, and partly because there have been, they made a mistake there, unusually large, not usually large. They referred the word un. Cross-country evidence indicates a notable absence of automatic bounce back from investment slowdown. So there is a task in front of the government to revive the investment cycle, even if the recovery takes us back only halfway towards the peak. So that is why the survey said the animal spirits somehow need to be conjured back in the Indian economy. The question, therefore, does the budget revive the animal spirits? Obviously, by looking at the stock market, you would say the answer is no, but we have to look at the macro economy rather than the animal called stock markets. So, what did the budget do in terms of trying to revive sentiment, putting more money in the hands of businesses to be able to invest? The government has been following a certain methodological approach towards reducing the tax burden, income tax burden in particular, on corporate income. The announcement was made in 2015-16 budget, and in the subsequent three budgets, including this budget, the ceiling for corporate turnover at which the maximum tax rate is imposed has been increasing from 5 crores to 50 crores. Now in this budget they said 250 crores, which is 2.5 billion rupees. If you have turnover of 2.5 billion rupees or less, the tax rate is 25% and not 30%. Of course, there are surcharges and cess which make the calculation somewhat more complicated, and the overall tax incidence is even much higher. But the top tax rate up to 250 crores or 2.5 billion rupees has been lowered to 25%, and that's a good thing. And ad hoc exemptions have been phased out as well in the 2016-17 budget. See, as I mentioned in the last bullet point, if you really look at the overall tax incidence, including GST, including the cess, including the surcharges, the World Bank's ease of doing business says a typical mid-sized company in India still ends up bearing the overall tax burden of somewhere between 50 and 55% rather than the 25%. They include all kinds of labor taxes, indirect taxes, everything, and they calculate an overall tax incidence of a mid-sized company is in the north of 50s and not the south of 50s. The survey made a second point, because if you have to revive investment, you have to have an open attitude towards capital. So one of the things that I would say India's opposition party did a major disservice to the cause of investment revival and capital by calling this government a suit boot ki sarkar back in 2015, and that tag has stuck. And the government, unfortunately, has been working overtime to get rid of that tag by bending backwards to show that it actually isn't pro-capital but anti-capital. And that is the point that even the economic survey rather diplomatically mentions. The ambivalence relating to the private sector relates to the experience of Indian capital. The private sector, in fact, in India has always had to live with the stigma because it was midwifed in the era of the license quota permit raj of the 60s and 70s, maybe even the 50s. Of course, the survey does point out that it was a legacy inherited by the government, which made policy reforms very difficult. It's all understandable that, you know, when this government came to office in 2014 May, the banking non-performing asset problem has begun to sort of get bigger, and corporate balance sheets had begun to come under stress, and companies had to sell assets, etc. But the point is, because there were inherited problems, this government was able to come to office with a decisive majority. So there is only, there's a time limit up to which we can always throw the ball back in the court of the previous government. The question is, do we sort of pay more attention to the tag of being pro-capital, or do we do what needs to be done? But because of the political economy issues, the banking crisis was allowed to fester for almost 3 years. And finally, I think we have the insolvency and bankruptcy code, and the banks have been recapitalized. Maybe, in fact, as you might have heard yesterday, bank credit growth is now back in double digits. So that is probably the worst of the balance sheet contraction is behind India. But that said, I think the government's attitude towards business and capital is still somewhat under the scanner. It is still questionable. Are they looking at it favorably or not? Because I would have loved to see them accelerate the corporate tax reduction even for bigger companies and phase out the exemptions faster rather than keeping it restricted to companies under 250 crores. However, the reintroduction of a tax on long-term capital gains in the stock market, in my opinion, was a welcome move. No country in the world would say long-term is 12 months. In India, long-term capital gains were exempt from tax if you held the stock in your portfolio for 12 months and 1 day. So normally, conventionally, short-term must be about 36 months and long-term beyond that. And short-term capital gains tax at the overall income tax rates and long-term capital gains tax slightly lower. But for a country which requires more patient capital for real investments, to incentivize portfolio investment with a long-term capital gains tax exemption, zero rate, if you held stocks in your portfolio for more than 12 months, was a complete anachronism. It was financialization that India did not need. In fact, this government has removed the double taxation favoritism that Mauritius-based entities used to enjoy. It has now removed the long-term capital gains tax. It has made a beginning. There is much more that needs to be fixed there, but it is a good beginning in my opinion, and that wouldn't qualify as an anti-capital move in my opinion. The more I see is the income tax administration with respect to angel investing, etc., which I will come to later, that qualify as anti-capital. What about the labor market? What did this government do in this budget? One thing, again, I go back to the Fitch report. You can see here, India's labor force growth and employment rate was actually contracting in the years after the crisis of 2008, and in fact made a very, very slow recovery, only towards the 2014 and 15 and 16, and you can see the line, the employment rate line is taking back above the zero line after 2013 or 14. So clearly, there is some green shoots in the labor market, and one of the things that this government has done, not just in this budget, but in the previous three budgets, are all these measures that they have taken to incentivize companies to hire by saying that the government will bear a part of their contributions to provident fund, to pension funds, launching an apprenticeship scheme, and increasing maternity leave for women, etc. So I think some systematic approach to incentivizing hiring has happened. But in my opinion, the limits that they put on salary, within which these government debates are allowed, were too low to make a big difference to hiring. So the government had the right intentions, but the monetary limits within which these schemes were made eligible were somewhat too low to make a difference to hiring. However, in this budget, they did go a big leap here, they did take a big leap here, and they said the government would contribute 12% of the wages for the new employees in the Provident Fund, which is a pension fund scheme, for all sectors for the next 3 years. And I think the finance minister's speech did not specify any ceiling there. So I think that is a good thing. And I think it is important that the momentum that we are seeing in employment growth is carried forward. And I see this as an important measure which I had not looked at closely before. I looked at it for this presentation. And there's also some more additional incentives for hiring women workers, which is the paragraph number 80 of the budget speech, which is listed here. I think one thing the government should realize is that economic reforms in India are usually considered as bad words in the political lexicon, not in the economic lexicon. And governments try to pursue reforms more by stealth than through conviction, because the political economy sensitivity there. Because it's somehow seen as favoring the rich, powerful, and the upper class rather than the poor, which still constitute a fairly sizable portion of the economy. But the truth is, liberalization has worked. If you look at the paper by Xi and Plano, published in 2014, they show that in every country, developing or developed, if enterprises remain in business for a longer period of time, they will tend to employ more workers. That's natural. As companies survive and thrive, they will hire more workers. But in India, before 1990, the blue line shows, as companies and enterprises aged, their employment intensity actually came down. And post-1990, you can see that the red line, even though it has not really picked up in a big way, certainly it is not heading south. And if anything, the longer the enterprises are around, the more they begin to employ, which is what you would expect. They have done systematic study of United States, Mexico, and India based on data. So they basically show that post-1994, firm age and employment are becoming positively correlated in India, as you would expect, as should be the case. But it was not the case before. So it is important that the labor market reforms are carried through, and the budget ticks quite a few boxes there. But so we have looked at on the capital side, I think there are some question marks on government's commitment. On labor side, I would say they score better marks. But on other schemes, in general, the rhetoric is more in terms of development expenditure and national security, etc. But if you look at it, the blue line shows you, compared to what the government allows in the budget for defense spending, the actual utilization has been lower, and the blue line has been coming down south rather than going north. In other words, even after this government came to office, which has seemingly put much more emphasis on national security, the utilization of budgetary resources or actual capital expenditure by the defense sector is declining rather than improving. But you wouldn't get that picture by looking at the rhetoric. But the reality tells you otherwise. And this, by the way, you must read the story in Bloomberg Gadfly column by Andy Mukherjee yesterday. India has this bizarre treatment of angel investors in startup companies. And it says, if you're a domestic Indian resident investing in a startup, and if you paid a premium for the shares, that premium will be considered as income in the hands of the startup enterprise and taxed. Because if it exceeds the fair value, which the tax authorities would determine, how do you come up with a fair value for a startup company? So I think this is a big muddle, and it goes against the Startup India, Stand Up India campaign of the government. And there's also a discrimination between domestic and foreign investors here. It is a mess. And when it comes to agriculture, the government increases the support prices, but also imposes minimum export prices. I'm going to skip the discussion on the budget transparency. We can make the slides available on the ISAS website later, no problem with that. There are some cases where India collects cess from the public along with the taxes, but those cesses are not used for the underlying purpose for which they were collected. So they become part of the overall tax pool. So it is actually taxation by disguise, by stealth, because the cess is supposed to be earmarked for a specific item. And you can see that whether it is an education cess or an R&D cess, the money collected has not been utilized but has gone into the general pool. And I think the comments I wanted to make on the public attitude towards price increases, towards farmers, etc., also influence the government policies. But in the interest of time, I'm going to skip those portions and come straight to the summing up. India's growth challenges are deleveraging, demographics, and deglobalization. Companies are basically trying to improve their balance sheets. There is a demographic dividend supposedly, but we need to create the jobs. And the global economy is becoming more protectionist. The government has recognized some of the challenges. Demonetization was meant to increase the number of taxpayers, but it could be a rather massive surgery for a problem which probably needs time to be addressed. Hiring incentives have been put in place, but corporate tax reforms, in my opinion, have been minor and gradual. Given the scale of the investment slowdown, the savings slowdown, and the fact that India is far from emulating China's growth performance between 1979 and 2009, is there a willingness to work towards creating a consensus for more accelerated reforms in some areas? I would say the budget and the political reaction suggest that India is sticking to the gradual path rather than an urgent path as you would expect. So, if you want to assign a letter grade to the budget, I would say it scores a C plus. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Very good presentation. You spoke of confusion at the beginning. If we are, some of us left a little confused even now, I can assure you it's at a much higher intellectual level. So, okay, the next next on my list is you'd like to go? All right, so in which case we will have Ms. Sonal Varma of the Nomura Singapore Limited. And madam, the next 20 minutes is yours.
And thank you very much for your time. So let me focus on the budget and at the outset mention that there's just too much importance being given to a single budget as a signal of where this economy is going in the next 5 years. We obviously need to analyze the budget in the context of measures being taken by the government outside the budget to really, you know, form sort of a more holistic picture of where the economy is going. So that's what I'm going to try and do. Anant sort of set the context. India in the last 3 years seen as a big star performer in the emerging market basket because of the government focus on reforms, a central bank focused on inflation. So India is seen as a country which can actually, you know, see potential growth pick up over the next let's say 5 years. So the question is, does the budget change that view or not? And I mean, in a nutshell, I would say that the budget is not a game changer in either direction, positive or negative. At the margin though, there were some concerns, you know, that I do have, you know, post the budget, which I will discuss. First, let me focus on some of the positives on the budget, and you know, I would highlight three of them. You know, when we hear the budget speech, it appears that, you know, it's a very populist budget focused on common man, you know, health, agriculture. It just appears as if it's a very populist budget. But, you know, I think there's a lot of rhetoric and a lot of the talk is not backed by actual walk. What I mean is, for instance, the actual allocations being made to segments like, you know, rural, health, education have hardly budged. In fact, despite the number of, you know, times rural economy has got a focus, the actual allocation increase on rural sector, for instance, is up less than 2% over last year's level. So we need to be careful, you know, in terms of sifting out the reality from the talk that we hear from the budget. But if you look at measures outside the budget, because this is a picture that the budget would give you, but if you look at these measures and the reforms that the government has enacted outside the budget, there have been a number of reforms to try to, you know, well, the focus, as you know, of this government is to double rural incomes over the next 5 years. And one of the ways the government is trying to double agricultural incomes is through agriculture marketing reforms. So you can, of course, double incomes by either ensuring, you know, costs go down or you get more return, you know, you, or you make more profit. So essentially right now a substantial part of the profit is made by the middlemen and the agriculture marketing reforms by trying to connect the consumer directly with the producer, farmer in this case, is trying to ensure that every rupee earned, a bigger part of that actually goes to the farmers rather than to the middlemen. So I think there are measures taken outside the budget to try to boost rural incomes, but really not so much in the budget. That's firm. Second, similarly, when it comes to infrastructure, I would in fact criticize the budget to say that there is no talk but a lot of walk. The actual allocations for the infrastructure sector in this budget are actually up 25% over last year's level. A lot of the spending actually going into railways, roads, for instance. And I think, you know, like I said, there's a lot of focus on the budget. But if you look at the total capital expenditure made by different sectors in the economy, almost 70% of the spending, the money for the spending comes from outside budgetary resources. So you do have, you know, for instance, railways where the money is raised by the public sector rail entity, you know, through the corporate bond market or through its internal savings. So 70% of the money actually is coming from outside the budget. Budgetary allocations have indeed gone up. You know, this is of course, you know, the outcome, the allocation that has happened. But if you actually look at the progress on infrastructure in terms of actual physical milestones, not allocations, I would say that there has also been an improvement on that front. So for instance, the actual capital expenditure being done by Indian Railways, what they've done in the first 2 years and the plan for the next 3 years is actually three times the capex that Railways has done in the last 5 years. Similarly, in the road sector, the road awarding activity is up actually five times. The actual construction is up two times. In the renewable energy space, both for wind as well as solar, the actual generation is double what we've done, you know, in the previous year. And you know, I can mention a lot more examples in the case of smart city, etc. But the point being that, you know, you do have budgetary allocations, you have outside budgetary resources which are being used for infrastructure spending. I think India needs a lot more on infrastructure than we are doing right now. You know, we keep talking about the problem of jobs, problem of growth, and really the answer to all these problems is infrastructure. And on that front, you know, I think there's actually a decent move that we are seeing, and that's a positive, both within and outside the budget. The third positive I would mention is really on the revenue collection side. Now, the context of this, of course, is that India, if you look at India from an aggregate position on the fiscal front, whether you're looking at India's, you know, fiscal deficit to GDP or debt to GDP, India actually stands out as having one of the worst fiscal positions in the emerging market basket, especially if you look at the, you know, similarly rated BBB- countries. The question is why? And when you compare the, you know, spending and the revenue share, then clearly what comes out is that it's not that India spends a lot more, it's just that India collects less in terms of revenue. So a big part of fiscal consolidation in India has to be driven by more revenue raising measures. And I think one big change we have seen in the last 2-3 years is that there has been actually an increase in the total revenues that the government and the country is collecting. So within the last 3-4 years, gross tax collections as a share of GDP have moved up from 10 to almost 12% of GDP. You know, some of you would have seen after GST, there's been almost a 50% increase in new businesses that have actually registered. Post demonetization, there's been a 25% increase in income tax filing. So a lot of these reforms that are going on, which are trying to push a bigger part of the Indian economy towards the formal sector, which is going to have some positive effects, including the fact that the revenue raising capacity of the economy is also picking up. So I think that's the other positive I would point out too. But like I said at the start, you know, there were some concerns, you know, that I thought did emerge for me, at least in the budget. The primary one is that, and this is, so the primary one really is that I think at the margin, some shades of populism are starting to emerge. We have seen fairly prudent policies being enacted by the government in the last 3 years, given that we have a very heavy election calendar coming up, you know, 8 state elections in 2018 and of course a big election next year, perhaps it's not a surprise that some shades of populism are emerging. And in particular, I would say that the government, from focusing a lot more on the consumer in the sense of trying to keep food inflation low, has now switched to trying to protect the food producer in the sense that ensuring food inflation does not fall too much, which is a big change from a macroeconomic perspective. We have seen a number of policy announcements in this context. In the budget, the biggest announcement was the fact that the minimum support prices going forward will be linked to at least 1.5 times the cost, whatever measure of cost you know, that is being used. There have been actually outside the budget a number of trade policy measures, you know, import tariff, export tariff. Anant mentioned the minimum export price. The changes being made essentially are to ensure that domestic prices do not fall very substantially. And I think you know, one of the reasons why India is recognized as a more stable fundamental, more stable economy is the fact that inflation has come down. And if government policies start to change in terms of supporting food inflation more through such direct measures rather than through more productivity enhancements, then there is a risk of some inflation comeback. So that was clearly one negative from me. The second is really the pace of fiscal consolidation. Anand had an interesting chart on that. You know, we've been trying to target 3% fiscal deficit since 2007. The target now is for 2021. The pace of fiscal consolidation, so while the focus is still to consolidate fiscal finances, the pace of medium-term fiscal consolidation is actually slower than what was indicated earlier. So that was a bit of a disappointment. And third, there are a few segments, for instance, you know, mobiles, TVs, few electronics, but actually custom duty has been increased in this budget with the objective to essentially make in India and create jobs. And of course, the question is whether imposition of the duty is going to lead to production or will it lead to just domestic inflation and domestic prices picking up, because, you know, on a steady state sustainable basis, it's not possible to, you know, produce something in the country if you don't have the right ecosystem also available. So you know, that is clearly not going to help when it comes to job creation. So, you know, those were of course you know, a few of the disappointments in the budget. But on an overall basis, I think, you know, we have to clearly look at, like I was saying at the beginning, you know, we have to analyze the budget, not looking at just what has been announced in the budget, but also the measures that have been announced outside the budget. And if we take both those things into account, then I think the more medium-term outlook actually for India is still looking positive, because where there is talk, there isn't walk, and where there is a walk, there isn't enough talk. And thankfully, on infrastructure, there is, you know, actual walk. That is clearly positive. But like I said, at the margin, the election cycle is here, and you know, that is something we need to keep a close eye on. With that, I conclude my addition. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It was very interesting, your sort of calibration of the walk talk metaphors, and also the problem you pointed to with regard to macroeconomic stability, even if that were to happen in some of our societies, the problem still could remain with the micro-implementation, as you talked of the collection of revenue, and all, of course, the disappointment of fiscal consolidation and Nanana, very, very real. And your sort of definition of what the budget is about, not just what is written and spoken. liberating budget. It's a broader conversation combining the entire policy structure of the government. Very good. Now we have, last but not the least, our own Dr. Duvvuri Subbarao, formerly of course the Reserve Bank, but now with us at ISAS.
Good afternoon. In making budgets, finance ministers are torn between fiscal virtue and political compulsions. This is true always and everywhere. The challenge for Mr. Jaitley was particularly acute because, as both Anantha-Nageswaran pointed out, and as all of you know, this is the last budget of the government before we go for elections next year. There was enormous pressure on the government to placate millions of poor people in the country who are arrested about growing agricultural distress, deepening unemployment, rising inequality. And the government was under pressure to do something for them. Just before Prime Minister Modi spoke in Davos 2 weeks ago, WEF put out the World, Inclusive Development Index. And India ranked 62 behind China, 26th. This is a surprise, behind Pakistan, 47th. So inequality is growing. In the event the finance minister decided to leave the big office for consolidation to take on some additional expenditure commitments. In my own view, I think we got a balance of it. The budget has many positives, many negatives, and some issues on which it is less difficult to take an informed view. Since I don't have time to talk about all of them, I'm going to talk about two positives of the budget, two negatives, and two issues on which it is difficult to make a judgment. The first positive, in my view, is certainly the National Health Insurance Plan. As the Prime Minister called it, by far the largest health insurance initiative in any democracy in the world. The details are by now quite familiar. Health cover of up to 500,000 rupees for each family, 100,000 families in the country. That in Singapore dollar terms, that translates to health insurance of 10,000 Singapore dollars per family per year. In a country with a per capita income of about 2,400 Singapore dollars, where nearly half the population do not have any health insurance cover, this is certainly a very, very well deserved safety net measure. The World Bank prescribes that emerging economies should spend about 3% on health, should spend at least 3% of GDP on health. India spends 1.4%. China spends 3.1%. Sri Lanka spends 3%. African countries, Ghana, Rwanda, Ethiopia, do better as a proportion of health spending, as a proportion of GDP than India. So this there's a very strong case for increasing public expenditure on health. Public health experts, of course, would argue that is this the best way of spending money? That the burden of disease in India is very high. Millions of children still die from preventable diseases like malaria, like diarrhea, like pneumonia. They've done experiments in India. They've forced feed children 1,500 to 1,800 calories per day, but they do not show any pickup in health. They're still malnourished because the sanitary conditions, for the hygiene conditions are very, very poor. So public health experts would argue, even in this case, I'm sure it'll come up, that this money could have been better spent on public health rather than curative. But even setting aside the debate, let's say this is a good expenditure, it raises two questions. Can the government afford this? That's the first question. Initially, hours after the budget, we were all concerned about how much it might cost, but now the government has come out with some numbers, and I believe it costs about 23 Singapore dollars, 1,100 rupees per family per year, which is a premium. I think that's a reasonable thing that the government state government, central government, and the beneficiary can together contribute. The second question, of course, is whether the country has the healthcare delivery system, which I think is a very, very big issue. But on the whole, I believe that that's a positive. The second positive of the budget, in my view, is the convergence that the finance minister brought across certain schemes. This may not look very big sitting here in Singapore, it may not look very big in Delhi, it may not look very big from Jaipur or Chennai or Hyderabad, but at the frontier level, at the field level, it matters quite a lot. Because in India, we have public health centers, we have doctors, because doctors are not being provided for, the schools without teachers. We have X-ray machines which pick up cobwebs because there's no X-ray technician job sanction. So integrating schemes matters quite a lot of the field. Some things that the finance minister has done, for example, 22,000 grameen agricultural markets, folding in allocations from the employment program, from the roads program, I think it's a good thing. Similarly, the horticulture sectors, horticulture clusters now are being set up, folding in allocations from agriculture, from horticulture, from food processing, from commerce. I think that's a good thing. So what the finance minister has done to break silos is another positive feature. Now let me come to the negatives. The first on my negative list is the split on fiscal consolidation. Sonal, of course, was more forgiving of the government than I would be. I believe that stepping up or relaxing on fiscal consolidation is one of the questionable and by far the most disappointing decisions of this government. Finance ministers in India have often hit the pause button. Every time they hit the pause button on fiscal consolidation, they've said that this time is different. I'm under compulsion. But next year onwards, I'll be disciplined. It's like St. Augustine saying, God give me chastity, but not yet. So, every time we've relaxed on fiscal consolidation, we have to pay heavy macroeconomic costs. This time around, there is criticism, actually, that the fiscal deficit is higher than what the budget predicts because the finance minister has assumed a higher GDP, higher nominal GDP. The government has brought this investment proceeds from SPCL, which is a leveraged buyout. This bank recapitalization borrowing that the government is doing for that has been not reckoned in fiscal deficit. There's unfunded health insurance, unfunded MSP. So there's criticism that the fiscal deficit could actually be higher. But even admitting that the budget number is accurate, I think it's going to lead to discomfort. Why? For at least four reasons. The first reason is that interlocutors around the world who make a judgment on India take fiscal consolidation as the basis on which to judge the government's reform credentials. The FRBI, Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management Act, as Sonal said, mandated that we must bring fiscal deficit down to 3% in 2007-8. Now it's been pushed to 2021. This creates a credibility gap. India's credit rating was raised because the government showed initially that they would be fiscally disciplined. Now they slipped up on that. The second reason fiscal deficits are bad is because any excesses on the fiscal spill over into the balance of payments. We had a crisis in 1991 because of fiscal profligacy of the entire agency. We had a near crisis in 2013 when I was governor because of the fiscal profligacy starting with the global financial crisis. So once again, there are concerns that we're seeing a twin deficit problem. a higher fiscal deficit, a higher transit fund deficit. For the last 2-3 years, the government has enjoyed some positive turns of trade shock to cover the lower prices. But next year, current account deficit will be under pressure. Fiscal deficit is going up, so there's going to be pressure of the twin deficit problem. The third reason fiscal deficits are bad is because interest rates will go up, and the RBI will be under pressure to maintain a tight monetary policy. In fact, yesterday the Reserve Bank released a statement, and they were quite unforgiving of the government. What is more worrying than the quantum of fiscal deficit is the quality of adjustment. If the government borrows and spends it on capital expenditure, that is good, because if they invest, tomorrow growth will go up and generate tax revenue for the government, which out of which they can pay the debt. But if the government borrows and spends on current expenditure, that is going to add a problem. It is like, for those of you who don't understand budgeting, for it's like if you borrow money to pay your daughter's college fee, that's a good expense. But if you borrow money to party or to travel, that's a bad expense. So I think government borrowing for current expenditure is going to add the problems. What is worrisome is that if you add the central government's fiscal deficit, fiscal deficit of states, the combined picture is even worse. Some people argue that all this is fiscal fundamentalism. Actually, government should borrow and spend. Two things they say. First, the debt-GDP ratio of India is relatively small. Look at Japan, debt-GDP of 250%. Look at Mexico, look at some other countries, India debt-GDP ratio only 60 or 65%, whatever. Like Sonal said, India's debt-GDP ratio is low, but India's revenue-GDP ratio is also low. So we can get into our debt pressure at a much lower debt-GDP ratio. We must keep that in mind. The second thing people say is, why, what's the problem done with this borrowing money and spending for the welfare of poor people? That's a good thing. Consumption will go up. If consumption goes up, growth will go up and government revenues will go up. Actually, it may not work that way. If inflation goes up because of all this expenditure, it will completely offset government's intentions. So I think the arguments of people who say that borrowing and spending is a good thing are not valid. Finally, this is the final thing I want to say on fiscal deficit. I think the finance minister, this finance minister, has not been tested. In the last 3 years, it's had a fairly comfortable time, with oil prices being soft, food prices being low because of good monsoons. But now for the first time it's been tested, and I think it's not come out with flying colors. And in my view, if you take a long-term view, or even a medium-term view, it pays for a country like India to be wooden-headed about fiscal consolidation. The second negative thing I want to say about the budget is some of the regressive steps that the finance minister is taking. MSP, for example, 1.5 times the cost price. You've got to put the agricultural districts, you've got to do this for the farmers, etc., etc. But the point is, if you raise MSP, it's location. People, landless poor, hundreds of millions of landless poor will be hit. So you are trying to protect farmers who have land at the cost of landless labor, who have no land. So there is no completely benign policy, there is no completely benign public policy. It's all a question of how do you measure the costs and benefits. But in this case, I think they've got the balance wrong. Similarly, raising customs duty on 50 items, as Sonal said, it will stoke inflation, number one. Number two, the Prime Minister goes to Davos on 23rd January. 23rd January, the press protectionism portrays India as a champion of globalization. 2 weeks later, this finance minister slaps Kashmir. There is a huge credibility gap about what India, whether India can walk the talk. Well, ostensibly, customs duties have been increased to support local manufacturing. So will it promote Make in India? Not sure. Will it create employment? Not sure. Will it hurt consumers? Sure, it will. So I think measures like this, raising MSP, I'm just citing two, raising MSP or raising customs duties are not are aggressive measures. Since 1991, every year the budget has been reducing import tariffs, customs tariffs. This time, for the first time, the finance minister reversed it, and that again creates credibility gap. So, those of you following me have spoken so far about two positives or two negatives, and I want to talk about two issues on which I want to reserve judgment. The first issue on which I think judgment has to be reserved is on employment, on addressing the country's huge employment challenge. Prime Minister Modi stepped into office in 2014 on the promise of creating jobs. He promised millions of youth in the country that he will fulfill their aspirations by creating jobs. The finance minister responded in this budget by doing a number of things. One of them is this government contribution to the employee provident fund, a number of other things. I don't know to what extent they will create additional employment. The most important thing India needs to do in order to create employment is to make investment. Investment went up 38%, right? Went up to 38%, the GDP is now below 30%. On the other hand, 12 million youth are joining the labor force every year. We're not even creating 6 million jobs. So not only is the employment problem larger, but it's getting larger and more complex every year. Investment, of course, is a problem that Prime Minister Modi and the government inherited, they did not create it. But have they done enough to solve it is the question. They got this twin balance sheet problem that they talked about. I don't want to go into details, but investment will not pick up until the balance sheets of banks and the balance sheets of corporates are addressed and the government has unveiled a plan for recapitalizing banks, has put the bankruptcy process in stream, and the expectation is that investment will start picking up. When that pickup will come, when that turnaround will come, of course, is uncertain. Ease of doing business is another thing that will contribute to investment. India jumped from 30 places, I think, we are now broken to the first top 100 in the ease of doing business, which is a very good thing. But again, whether we can walk the talk. Prime Minister said in Davos that we need this in the red tape, the red carpet. I, as part of my civil service career, at state level, at the federal level, as a governor of the Reserve Bank, one of the things I had to do was promote investment in India. We made a lot of potential entrepreneurs like our chairman, Mr. Pillay. You know, all of them come to us and say, if you want to invest $4 billion, $5 billion, and it had full effect. I know we were in China last week, and the Chinese said that they'll give us all the clearances within 3 months. And we said, oh, okay, Chinese said that. We'll give it to you in 2 months. The Chinese actually deliver, they said 3 months, they deliver in 2 months. Indians, we said 2 months, we don't deliver even in 2 weeks. So I think India has to improve much, much more on ease of doing business. So, while the government has done a lot of things to promote employment, to push employment up, it's a very huge, complex challenge that the government inherited. They've done a lot of things, but we still have to reserve judgment on whether this is sufficient beginning to make a reasonable, credible headway on the empowerment problem. The second issue on which there is a judgment is this issue of whether the monetization that we did in November 2016 has had a positive impact. The economy paid a heavy price. The people of the country paid a heavy price. It was pain, hardship. We were told at the time by the government that all the pain and hardship in the short term, in the long term, this will yield very positive benefits. I don't know what your definition of long term is, but I believe we're in the long term now. So, has it yielded positive results? The initial expectation, although the government never said it in so many words, was that about 15 to 20% of this money has been canceled or demonetized, will not come back. So the Reserve Bank will have a surplus, that surplus will transfer to the government. Government will have a windfall profit. They can then distribute out to the people and pay all the work. The Prime Minister said at some time that he will give 15 lakh rupees to every account of money. So that's what they expected to do. All the resources and so on. But that did not happen. All the money came back. And we were then told that the tax departments are trolling the accounts, trolling the deposits, and trying to discover where that money is. What's come out of that is not yet clear. But we have some numbers now. Both the economic survey and the finance minister's budget speech expressed some disappointment, despondency about the tax need. They said the number of tax returns filed this time. But that has not resulted in a tremendously yield in tax. The finance minister read out numbers too, for salaried employees, about professionals, etc. So there was some disappointment that if this can't push number of tax returns, that is no indicator of the tax need. In fact, I was telling my chairman the other day getting more tax returns, the corporate tax shield might actually be a great job because you've got to go through all the tax returns. So I think the number of tax returns should be no indicator of the positive impact of demonetization. In my view, now that it's about a year and a half or 15 months or whatever, the government should appoint an independent commission to study the impact of demonetization. Not only to get their report straight, but I think as a policy guide for the future. So, I've lost this. Yeah, that concludes my presentation. I've spoken about two positives. First, the National Health Insurance Plan. The second, convergence across schemes. I've spoken about two negatives. Letting up on fiscal consolidation and the regressive tax and expenditure measures. And two issues on which there is a judgment. First, about the ability to create employment, begin to address the employment challenge. And the second is the positive impact of implementation.
Thank you very much. Very good talk, of course. And I like the structural balance between two positive, two negative. To reserve judgment on a perfect mathematical structure. I hope the budget is going to give us more to give balance. Okay, now I'm going to, we have a decent amount of time for the Q&A segment, which is a very good thing. I'll open the floor. I'm going to recognize you in a moment. I would ask you to sort of identify yourself, even though if I should know you, for the sake of our record, make your questions as short as possible, and also identify the agency whatever you represent. So, I will begin by recognizing Professor Mitra, Director of ISAS.
Thank you very much for three excellent papers.
My first question is addressed to Dr. Nageswaran and Ms. Sonal Varma, and the second question is to Dr. Subbarao. The first question is what I call about the paradox of democratic budgets. The democracies are about people, and budget is about getting good value for money. Ultimately, it boils down to an issue between haves and have-nots. Haves have the cash, have-nots have the vote, and the government has to have both. So is democratic budgeting ever possible? Now, both of you have used this concept of reform by stealth. Stealth is, don't talk, just do. Now, this is how India's liberalization of the economy was achieved under Manmohan Singh. So the question to you both is there any attempt at all at giving bread and circuses to the masses and doing the economy quietly, quietly? Now, some democracies have done it. In this country, for example, or in Korea, Japan, it was possible. So it's not the case that democracies can never do it. Is our democracy doing it? And beyond that, can our democracy do it? That's looking beyond this particular budget. To you, Subha, the question is about agriculture. Now, we all know that India's countryside is seething with discontent. It's seething with discontent because every class of people in the countryside has something to be unhappy about. You have talked about the landless. Very small peasants are suffering from the burden of agrarian wages, which have gone up dramatically because of NREGA. A small peasant without access to small technology can't just afford the current agrarian wages. They are unhappy. Bigger peasants are unhappy about the gradual withdrawal of subsidies. Now, support prices probably are a shock to them. Now, the problem is, we are talking about the union budget, and agriculture is a state subject. In a federal country like India, in the current state of agriculture, first of all, how good is this budget in terms of agrarian policy? Second, is there an agrarian policy in India at the moment? And what would you recommend? Thank you.
I mean, in a sense, you're asking if good economics is also good politics. And it's a question of time frame. It may be in the long term, but may not be in the short term. And therefore, the time horizons, of the government are clearly short. And given that, I think, and the experience of 2004, where India Shining completely collapsed, it cannot just be, talk with no walk. So I think, and therefore, I mentioned the fact that a lot of the positives have happened in the last 3 years. But the fact of the matter is that the government needs to come back to power. Rural economy has not been doing well. And ultimately, those are the guys who go out there and vote.
Like
I said, there were shades of populism in this budget, and in the next 1 year, given the political cycle, and given the fact that the good economics is not good politics in the short term, yes, in the long term, the focus potentially on more populist measures will be there.
I think since you said this question was way beyond this budget, one thing we have to remember that with respect to India, whatever statement you make, the opposite is equally true, whether it is positive or negative. I think the 1991 reforms were pretty much dictated by the balance of payments crisis, and the blueprint for reforms was drawn up by the government of Chandrasekhar under Yashwant Sinha. And Mr. Manmohan Singh implemented it under Narasimha Rao's political support. So that is the fact. Now, when this government took office, it was literally a scorched earth that it took over. Falling growth, double-digit inflation rate, a current account deficit that needed to be compressed, the threat of a credit rating downgrade. So it was not a benign environment that this government under which this government came to office, whereas in 2004, the previous government came to office under extremely benign circumstances and proceeded to make a mess of it. So, whether this government is pursuing the right things, I would say the track record is mixed. On hard infrastructure, on revenue mobilization, I think, and also on labor reforms, whether the outcomes are there or not is a separate issue. I always said to last week when we met also, I said, we need to judge the government on the basis of the actions that they are taking, because of employment generation, you needed multiple things to happen for it to become a reality. So I think on hard infrastructure and on labor market reforms, they are making far more genuine attempts than previous governments have done. I would definitely say that their track record with respect to health, education, and also with respect to using this banking crisis to bring about structural changes in the banking sector. In these three areas, they have failed, not to mention your follow-up question, Dr. Subbarao, on agriculture also. I would say on all these areas, they have relatively done, at best, a mediocre level of performance. So whether India's democracy is delivering or not is a much, much broader question, and I think I would request you to organize one more full day session before you leave. Thank you.
I have no answer for your question, for either question, but I have some comments. First, about whether it's a state subject, center subject, that's very clear. The Constitution very clearly laid out to what extent is a state subject, what is a center subject, what's a shared subject between the center and states. I think agriculture falls in the concurrent list. And to the extent that the government of India, central government, is giving money, states will be happy to take it. So they wouldn't contest saying that it's a state subject, don't interfere. They'll of course take the money, and they'll still cry for more. But that's the first part. But the more important thing, as you said, I don't want to be flippant, which is that there is enormous amount of agrarian discontent boiling over, actually. And the more they see, it's much worse than, say, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, because now people see on the TV and on their cell phones what's happening around the country, how other side is living. So there is much more anguish and anger about how they're being left behind. And that's all adding to the discontent. But I also want to say that in public policy, there is no completely benign decision. If you try to do something good for one segment of the population, it's got to come at the cost of someone else. I just pointed out MSP. You're helping farmers, you're having people who have land at the cost of people who have no land at all. Take the, take the schemes 7-8 years ago about the loan waiver for farmers. I was the finance secretary when that was done. A very, very popular scheme. But one criticism against the loan waiver scheme was that it was landed farmers, farmers with some influence, who got loans from financial institutions. The really poor farmers, the peasants, the landless, they borrowed from moneylenders. So what you forget was the debt of the relatively larger farmers. So there are no easy choices in public policy. I do have some comments on the first question that you raised about the number of things came up. You know, whether good economics makes good politics, etc. Across democracies, this is always a tussle between good economics and good politics. And in democracies, politicians have a very high discount rate. What this means is that if I ask everyone here, I will give you either $1 today or $2 tomorrow, 95% here, probably all of you, will say, I'll take $2 tomorrow. I can wait till tomorrow morning. Politicians will say, I'll take $1 today, because they're looking for gratification. Democracies run on a very short economic cycle. So they have to please the constituencies. I want to make also another comment about this reform by stealth. I think that's a wrong characterization of Indian reforms. It is true that the reforms that we did in 1991, in some sense I'm familiar, because
I was in the Ministry of Finance at that time. The reforms that we did in the first 3 months of 1991 were reforms by stealth. They necessarily, by definition, had to be reforms by stealth because they were reforms of the exchange rate policy, of the trade policy, etc. But every reform since then has been done in the open. The reason we are not able to reform labor is because it is not reformed by stealth. You have to consult the states. The reason we are not able to reform land is because we can't reform by stealth. We've got to consult the states. So this characterization of reform by stealth might sound very dramatic, but I think it's a complete mischaracterization of reform process anywhere, certainly reform process in India.
Thank you. All governments, I mean, you know, are faced with this problem of having to play a bit of Robin Hood. I mean, you have to sort of take, distribute, at the same time, keep maximum elements happy. Now, that's a very big challenge. I mean, as you said, even beyond budgets. You see, so the government is always, there is a bit of Robin Hood to play around with, and that's where politics, economics, and everything come together. And as leaders, you have to determine what is to be done when, and timing is very, very important. Yes, sir.
I'm Chairperson. I'm from State Bank of India. Dr. Subbarao spoke about fiscal consolidation, and he also spoke about the quality of fiscal deficit. And Sonal, she spoke about the FRBM Act and the 3% and all that. So we all know that a lot of expenditure is required in India on infrastructure. And with the health insurance, I mean, basically, I think you have to build up the health infrastructure. If there are millions of people who are given insurance, I mean, take insurance coverage, and tomorrow if you go to hospitals and all for treatment, obviously the health infrastructure has to be built up. So a lot of money is required to be spent in all these areas. So is it right that we should be constrained by this figure of 3% or 3.2% or 3.5%? I mean, I don't know on what basis are these figures fixed. I mean, the FRBM says it should be 3% of the GDP, the fiscal deficit should not exceed 3% of the GDP. I don't know what is the basis on which this figure of 3%, I mean, how do you arrive at this figure of 3%? And the second thing is, do you think that there should be different standards for developed and developing countries like India? Do you think that a country like India should have a higher fiscal deficit so long as maybe a particular act or a particular law can ensure that this whatever extra money, whatever is the extra fiscal deficit, the money is spent only for certain developmental purposes and not for this revenue expenditure. So what exactly do you think? I mean, do you think that we should have a much higher level of fiscal deficit, keeping in view the developmental needs of the country? And what is the basis on which these figures are fixed? I mean, 3.2. What is good, what is bad? Whether 3% is good, or 2% is good, or 5% is good? What is the basis?
Are you also asking where the health sector money should come from? Are you also asking that?
Yeah, I'm saying that since a lot of money has to be spent, the government should have the fiscal space instead of constraining itself by all these things.
I mean, I don't know where the number came from, possibly from the, you know, Eurozone stability, yeah. You know, the Maastricht Treaty. But, you know, the point of 3%, 5%, you know, I would say markets give us an answer. The ability of the domestic markets to actually absorb the amount of borrowing that the central and the state governments are doing gives an answer of whether this is high or low. And in the last 6 months, as you know very well, you know, the inkling of an extra borrowing from the central government has sent 10-year bond yields, you know, almost 100 basis point higher despite repo rate being at 6%. So the ability of the domestic system to absorb the extra supply is not there, which indicates that, you know, if we move from just the center from 3 to 5, which means that the consolidated deficit goes up from 7 to 9, the appetite to absorb it is not there. And if you actually open up the Indian economy right now, the the market is extremely closed. It's largely domestic banks which are holding these government bonds as, you know, as the what we call the SLR securities. If you actually open up the fixed income markets to foreign investors, where you have a deficit of 7%, you know, the volatility that we are going to face is going to be massive. So I definitely would not be in the camp of relaxing on the fiscal targets. I agree that we need to spend more on infrastructure, but we need to figure out how. And, you know, the first thing, of course, is that our revenue raising capacity has to go up. We could look at, you know, things like asset sales in order to help fund some of our infrastructure projects. But I also think that, you know, the size of our infrastructure requirements, and we are like 20 years behind where we should be. The size of the infrastructure requirement is so large that government's ability to do it by itself will not be there. So what steps do we need to make to get more private sector participation in the infrastructure financing is something we need to consider rather than relaxing on the fiscal front.
This question that you asked, whether governments borrow and spend so that with that additional expenditure they will generate growth. From that growth they will get additional tax revenue. With that additional tax revenue they will be able to repay the debt and service the debt. But this is not the first time this question has been raised. This is not the first context in which the question has been raised. It happens in every country, every situation, etc. So we can't, I don't think we can resolve that issue in this forum. But I want to answer specific questions that you've raised. First thing is, where did this number 3% come from? It's just a coincidence that when we did the FRBM, I think in 2003, the Maastricht number of 3% was very much in circulation. So people just put those two things together and say India blindly copied the Maastricht number, but I don't think so. I believe the government panel that worked on FRBM did some number crunching and determined that 3% fiscal deficit would be a good indicator, 3% for the central government, 3% for the states, and together 6%. But the recent MKC committee said that we should not go by the fiscal deficit, we should go by net GDP, and I think that's a good thing, I'll tell you why. In this budget, the entire additional net borrowing by the government, by the central government, is going towards meeting interest payments. So the more and more you borrow every year, the higher that your debt GDP ratio goes up, and the higher cost at which you borrow, the more of your revenue is preempted by interest payments, and the less is left for education, for health, for payment of salaries, pensions, and defense, etc. So, as I said in my presentation, if the government borrows and spends on productive expenditure, you can make a case. You can make a case. It's not necessarily the case, but you can make a case that the government should borrow and spend. But in a situation like India, where there is a revenue deficit, where your current revenue is not sufficient to meet your current expenditure, additional borrowing is an absolute, absolute no-no. That's why I believe that since we are a very vigorous democracy, the finance minister is under enormous pressure, not only from the people, but from his colleagues in the cabinet, and probably from the prime minister. There should be a wooden-headed rule that you cannot do this, you cannot pause. I think that will be a good thing for India.
And one short point on this is that when we look at the investment to GDP ratio, it's slightly under 30% right now. But the aggregate investment to GDP ratio of the broad government as defined as central, state and the public sector companies is only 5-6% of GDP. The remaining part of investment is actually coming from private corporate or the household sector. So if the 5% of the economy is going to borrow substantially more, raising the interest cost, the crowding out, as we call it, the negative impact of that on actually the bigger chunk of the private economy is going to be substantial. So the cost-benefit analysis ultimately we need to do, you know, given that, given those shifts. Thanks.
Okay. Yes, sir.
I have a supplementary question.
Identify yourself.
This is Manish from UTI. The question is that the fiscal deficit is tagged at 3.6. But these two important decisions which have been announced in budget about the national health insurance and as well as MSP, input plus MSP, is the panel thinks that the real number when after 1 year, instead of 3.6, it can be higher, much higher?
I think whether the final number is higher or lower will also depend on what happens to some of the revenue assumptions that they have made, including on, for example, this year, the year ending March 2018, on paper, they managed to raise more money than they budgeted on disinvestment. Of course, it was ONGC buying Hindustan Petroleum is not exactly disinvestment in some sense, but we will leave that aside for the moment. But I think so whether this results in a higher deficit, you should remember that in all these 3 years of this government, they have actually underestimated revenue growth. The actual revenue growth has been higher than what they had budgeted for. So you should keep that in mind. So I think it's right now, it is too early to speculate. Plus, this they may face in this health expenditure, national health insurance, it may happen over a period of time. And also the MSP depends on whether the market prices turn out to be substantially lower and the government has to step in. If it is not required to step in, then there is no need for, it's only, you must treat it as a price guarantee. It is not an actual, it is a contingent liability. It is not an actual liability or actual expenditure. If the market prices don't recur, then the government needs to procure at 1.5 times, then probably the amount of outlay, therefore, that this announcement will require will depend on actual market conditions.
Okay. I'm not sure I agree with that, because the budget is budget estimates.
Yeah.
So the government, I think, is enjoined to give some estimate of what the expenditure will be. They cannot say that it depends on the market.
The MSP announcement, I would say it is not exactly a budget fiscal consequence related announcement, it is a policy announcement. I think this would depend on the underlying conditions. I'm not sure, I would probably stick to my observations.
Can I just add, the short answer is yes. They have under budgeted for the health scheme, and the MSP, the direct effect is just on this food subsidy bill, but the indirect effect on inflation and the overall revenue expenses will go up the more you have inflation, will lead to more expenditure. But what we've seen historically is that the quality of consolidation, you know, capital expenditure takes the axe, and I think that's where the problem lies at the end of the day. It's not the number, it's basically the quality of consolidation that we'll get after a year.
Okay, no consensus on the panel. Anyway, oh, yes, sir.
My name is Mahesh from Kingdom Patch. A sense of entitlement has crept in over the years from different segments. The middle class, the salaried class, they all have their expectations, mostly in terms of tax reductions. My question to you is, do you think in the future any government would dare to have agricultural income to be taxed? Because many politicians are also classifying themselves as farmers. Thank you.
Vivek Devroy says that agriculture must be taxed in a statement, right? That agriculture must be taxed, and I've read several comments and commentary on that. I think it is a good case for taxing agriculture. This is not a subject that I've studied, but from whatever I have read, I think a lot of evasion is taking place because people are able to disguise non-agricultural income as agricultural income. So I think it's a good case for taxing agriculture.
I'll just add one sentence to what he said. If the government lets farmers sell whenever, wherever, at whatever price they can, then I think the case for agricultural income to be taxed will go up enormously. Right now, there is a lot of rhetoric on farmers, but the truth is, when the international market is in short supply and the government of India imposes a minimum export price, the very idea of the government setting an export price when the global market will set the price is ridiculous. And then we have an inflation target domestically. So we have to choose between whether we want to double the farm income or we want to have an inflation rate of 4%. First of all, there is nothing sacrosanct about a 4% inflation rate. Economies can perform perfectly well even at 5 to 7% inflation rate. So the question of whether India needs an inflation targeting framework of 4% and whether it militates against boosting farmers' income needs to be addressed. If those inconsistencies are addressed, then the case for taxing farmers' income will become much stronger.
Yeah, and this is a problem throughout the throughout South Asia, I think. I mean, the problem of where to tax agriculture, etc. It's a hugely political issue and how to determine who's a farmer and who's a peasant. And there is where you have to make the line. I mean, it's the same in Pakistan, same in Bangladesh.
I have one more follow-up observation. From my observation, organic farming and organic farmers are doing very well in India compared to the other non-organic. I have interacted and gone to a lot of rural parts of India, and that's my first-hand experience.
Okay, good. All right, you first and then.
Yeah, good evening. I'm Parikshit from India. So, as against employment, the government has actually put forward two important points. One is they are on record, non-BJP state governments are claiming 4 crore jobs on their official website. So, that needs to be considered. And second, regarding Mudra loan that they have disbursed, so which the central government has disbursed during their tenure, they claim that around 10 crores. A loan that they have disbursed, and out of those 10 crores loan that the government has put through Mudra loan, 3 crores were new applicants. So this is their response to the employment steps that they have taken to control employment. So what is finance minister Mr. Chidambaram has completely rubbished that argument. So by giving loans to unemployed people will actually not solve the employment problem. So what is the panel comments on this? By disbursing Mudra loan, let's say, so 3 crore people who have got loan for the first time, will that create some kind of job and jobs in the economy? So is this move in correct direction or not?
Ultimately, these are all empirical questions. It's difficult to answer purely in terms of whether it... First of all, you need to allow time. The Mudra scheme was announced in 2015-16 budget, and it's been 2 years in the making. So I would say whether these are, first of all, meant to be self-employed, entrepreneurial borrowers for them. Now, if you take Bandhan, a microfinance institution turned a bank, they do give, for example, enterprise loans. But they say when the same enterprise comes to them for renewing the loan, they actually impose certain conditions on your employment should have doubled. If you had one employee, next time when you want to come back for a loan again, you should have at least 2 employees, if not more. So Mudra loans can indeed play a role in not only employment generation, but also more professionalization of the enterprises if certain performance-related conditions and training is also made part of the Mudra loan. And I think if you look at the Mudra website, they do say that these are all part of their interventions, just other than giving them the money. So at this point in time, I would say without evidence, I can't say, well, it is creating jobs or it is not creating jobs. And in general, I would say from a policy perspective, my sense is that as far as government doing whatever it can in terms of creating employment, I think this government hasn't done too badly. That's my view.
First, I think that the employment problem of India is so huge and so complex that there can be no simple or single solution. You've got to do an enormous number of things. And Mudra is one part of trying to address the employment challenge. If 10 crore loans have been given, I can't verify the numbers that you've quoted, Parikshit, but if 10 crore loans have been given and if some enterprises have started and there was some employment generated or livelihood generated, I think that's a good thing. The second thing about what Mr. Chidambaram had said, I've not exactly followed what he said, but there's been some debate in the last 1 month about what constitutes employment. If somebody is started an enterprise and the government supports that person to start the enterprise and he makes a livelihood out of that, is there employment? That's the question that has come up. And people who made that charge have defined employment as salaried employment. That at the end of the month, at the end of the fortnight, you get some fixed salary. I don't agree with that. I think that if you government encourages people to start enterprises and thereby they earn a livelihood, even if they're taking a risk and not salaried employees, I think that's employment.
I mean, I think the biggest challenge is that we don't know. I mean, there's no absolutely no data on employment, so you know anybody can make any statement. So we don't know honestly. But it just seems like mudra is not enough with respect to the requirement of job creation. And I think my biggest concern is that the world that we are getting into, where there's a lot more, you know, artificial intelligence, mechanization, robotics being used in manufacturing. The world is moving away towards the next century and, you know, we are still trying to create manufactured jobs, labor intensive. We are not ready for tomorrow and I think we need to focus on tomorrow.
Okay, tomorrow from ISAS on her first day as fellow at ISAS.
Thank you. So my question is a more political one. Given that the budget has been marketed as a pro-development budget with emphasis on agriculture, rural investment, and health, or Modi care, as it's starting to be known, but these are all areas where some of the investments and the type of increased investments will take a while to work out. I'm wondering what your predictions are for early poll, in that the marketing of this as being a pro-development budget, and some of the panelists have said that, you know, there might be under-budgeting for health, etc., so whether it actually is a pro-development budget, but taking advantage of these new schemes that have been put in and then calling an early election. What are your thoughts on whether how the politics of this budget will play out?
It's also been called pro-India budget.
I think your question contains a kernel of the answer, which is that if these announcements do take some time to deliver results, then it doesn't make sense for the ruling party to call for an early election, but to utilize the maximum possible time allowed under the constitution rules for the fruits of these schemes to bear, to come through to the population, so that there is a little bit of a feel-good effect on the part of the voters. But I don't think that particularly helped 2004. That's a different story. But as for other than this answer, if you really ask me whether there would be early election or not, I will spin a coin and decide depending on heads or tails. I really don't think there is any particular compelling case for them to advance. That's the timetable. That's my view.
So I think the pro-development works with the urban population. It's really the rural India which has to be convinced, and that cannot happen just based on announcements. The result of the Gujarat election and, you know, the rural outcome there clearly was disappointing, and I would suspect that the sort of shift in government policy that we have, you know, seen in the last couple of months, which, you know, we have all talked about, indicates that potentially there is some concern, you know, that the government sees, specifically with respect to rural, because, you know, announcement is one, on the ground there should be an effect. So you know, the only rationale for calling an early election would be that, you know, towards end of 2018 there are some very big states that are going for elections, Rajasthan, I think MP, Chhattisgarh, and instead of waiting for their results to influence voters in the elections, you know, rather hold them all together. But other than that, I don't think it's better to wait like Anand was saying.
But if the idea is to do good, then why now? Why not early? Why when there are only months left? All the stuff could have been.
Yeah, that is true. I think part of the reason was they were, first of all, in the initial years, they were still focused on the consolidation of the budget in order to make sure that the credit rating was not disturbed. And even though on paper they inherited a 4.1% budget deficit, in reality, as the first economic assessment report of the new government stated in December 2014, the true budget deficit that they inherited was much higher than that. And it was at least 1.2% more than the official budget deficit that they inherited. So given that, I would say that they were actually consolidating from around 5% or 5.5% rather than from 4.1%. So they had to use the first 3 years and the oil price bounty to I will again use the word, to do fiscal consolidation by stealth. And they are waiting for the demonetization fruits, as Subbarao pointed out, that they were thinking that 20% of the money wouldn't come back and they would cancel some liabilities and there would be a nice opportunity for a Robin Hood distribution, but that didn't happen. So this was probably the earliest possible opportunity, which is kind of close to the election cycle, that they could do it. And maybe there was a sense of urgency imposed upon by the Gujarat outcome that Sonal alluded to.
Okay. So, Rani, in response to your question, there's one comment that comes to mind. A lot's been written about the budget, but one comment somebody made, which is that a government that's been in office for 4 years should be running for the next election based on its performance rather than promise. So it's some commentary on how the government has performed, how they perceive their performance.
Okay, one final question, back of the room.
Hi, my name is Tyagesh, I'm a consultant. Pardon me if I don't understand the intricacies of the accounting behind the budgeting exercise, but one thing that's always intrigued me is the forex reserves of the country. Probably it falls a lot more under the RBI's ambit rather than the government's. But one thought is there room for a part of it to be capitalized in some way and form and brought onto infrastructure investments? Because we keep boasting about a lot of accruals to the forex reserves. Nothing seems to be done about it except on the RBI's balance sheet. Now, and it's sizable enough too. So is there room for it? Is that being missed completely? Because one rarely hears about that in the budget speech nowadays.
And there is no room. And the answer is there is no room. Because India's credibility, to a large extent, is determined by the strength of the balance sheet of the government and the balance sheet of the Reserve Bank. As soon as the Reserve Bank starts giving away those reserves for other purposes, the trust in the central bank balance sheet will be dented, and that will cause enormous damage. Even though you're asking this question perhaps for the first time here, it's a debate that we've gone through in India. When in 2010, 2011, the government, the planning commission, have all said the same thing that you're saying, that we have these reserves, they should be spent on infrastructure. I don't think we should be doing it.
Okay, if there be no further questions, queries, comments, we will conclude this session, which was an extremely stimulating session, I think. I mean, if the political masters in Delhi were to listen to this, I think they would have profited enormously. One socio-political extrapolation or takeaway from this is, eventually, all governments, particularly in our epoch, even if they start as suit, boot, etc., eventually they have to go to the agrarian masses. This is what we call walking on two legs. You respond to the market on one leg, but eventually you have to cast your social net wide to catch the one who has fallen through, or who is likely to fall through, to spread the net wider. That is a social responsibility that all our governments have to eventually discharge. And that is extremely, extremely important for what we call good governance all across the world.
Thank you very much, panelists. I'll hand over to the MC now.
Dr. Chowdhury, now distinguished panelists, for this insightful and in-depth discussion on the India budget. On behalf of ISAS, Dr. Chowdhury will now present a token of appreciation to our guest panelists, Ms. Verma and Dr. Anantha-Nageswaran. Thank you.